such good colleagues here. And here. But I've been looking forward to this. Before we get started, let me just kind of find out something. What are the disciplines represented in the room? What disciplines are you from?
Sociology.
Okay.
Anthropology.
Accounting, anthropology.
Music.
Yeah.
Dentistry.
Psychology.
Psychology.
Engineering.
Math. Engineering.
Yep. Health science.
Health science.
Physics.
Physics.
Economics.
Nursing. Economics.
English.
History.
English. Let's stick with that just for the next hour. on literature to do literary stuff.
The be-all and the end-all of romantic love was... Mike?
Sex.
Mike! Sex on the brain, Mike, right? Yes.
Marriage.
Marriage, that's right. But it wasn't always like that. Around the 12th century, there was a notion known as courtly love, where love had nothing to do with marriage and nothing to do with sex. In most cases, it was defined as a passionate relationship between a knight and a lady of the court who was already married, and so they could never consummate their love. In this way, they would have to rise above your ordinary, going to the bathroom in front of each other kind of love, right? And they would go after something more divine. They took sex out of the equation, and what was left was a union of souls. Now think of this. Sex was always the fatal love potion. Look at the literature of the time. Lancelot and Guinevere, Tristan and Isolde, all consummation could lead to was madness, despair, or death.
This is A Mirror Has Two Faces. Has anyone seen this movie and recall how this scene ends? Standing ovation. That's how I pass it. So, in this scene, admittedly Hollywood, Barbra Streisand, we see a glimpse into a kind of literature classroom. If learning is a reflection of teaching, what does it mean to teach, learn, do literary studies, according to this role? What do you see? Yes.
Well, I like to talk about technique as opposed to substance. Okay. And the technique I particularly like is how she moves around the classroom and engages people with eye contact and modulates her voice. So for technique, the large classroom, I really like this. Now, I know nothing about literary studies, so I can't help you on the
site. Good. More. What about narrowing it down specifically to learning, teaching, doing literary studies? What did you see? Yes?
Enthusiasm.
Enthusiasm? Say more.
Passionate about the subject and conveying that.
Good. What else?
She was bringing together examples from a variety of books, so she was pulling themes from across literature to really drive home those important things.
Good, very integrated. Good, what else? Oh, yes.
She also used humor, so she was talking about the text, but then she made a comment like a bathroom sort of love and people chuckled, to bring it back to what some of the students would be familiar with.
Good. Used humor, that really engaged the students.
I think she was really challenging our general assumptions about what do we think about love and romance, and this is what we usually think, but really there's all this other stuff going on that we sometimes are mistaken as about the
next. Good. Literature kind of challenges our general assumptions. Yeah.
Literature can be fun.
Yeah.
Right. It's not just this dull, dry stuff. It sounds like she's having fun.
Who was having fun?
The students were having fun, but also she was having
fun. She was having fun, and the students were having fun. More.
Well, to see another day, not knowing anything about the objectives of the course, if one of them was to encourage the students to become literary scholars, this is still, while it's a fun performance, it's still very much a stage on stage kind of performance. There's not a whole lot of interaction, supposedly maybe one question to the group. But it's still her talking and other people sort of passively listen.
Yeah. So what does it mean to learn literary studies in this class?
Listen.
Who's doing the interpreting? Who's doing the literary study? Who's doing the engaging with the text? Who's doing the integration? So I'm not sure. We certainly can learn from her expertise, her demonstration, what an expert looks like in literary studies, and keen viewers can really see there's integrated thinking. thinking, there's relevance, there's engagement and humor, there's good technique dealing with a large class, but I'm not sure how much the students are learning about doing the work of literary study. Lyndall Calder, we'll see a little bit more about him shortly, but Lyndall Calder has written about what students think about history when they come into the history classroom. He says, they think that history is what you find in a textbook, a stable, authoritative body of knowledge that when remembered somehow makes the world a better place. So history is the stable body of knowledge. Randy Bass, English and American Studies, recalls prepping for class, getting ready for class in the front of the room and hearing students in the front row talking. And one of them, he hears one of them say, I can't believe Professor Bass thinks this is a great book. And he was shocked. I had to interrupt. I think this is a great book. I don't think it's a great book. I think it's an important book. So that moment when he learned what these particular students think literary studies is about, why we select the books that we select, what the discipline means. So, think about dentistry, economics, French, anthropology, math, English, library science, physics, the ones you called out. What do students initially think about your discipline? And then what are the consequences of those preconceptions? If students think that history is the stable body of knowledge, bounded facts, what are the consequences in their learning? What are the consequences in their doing history? What about physics? What do they think of physics? What do they need physicists to do? The Jurassic Park. Chaos theory. Charismatic Jeff Goldblum characters. Is that what they think? So think about, you probably have at least a gut sense of what students think it means to do your discipline when they come to the classroom. And then if learning is a reflection of teaching, how do you teach in ways that correct, build on, reinforce, or exacerbate those preconceptions? That's really what we're talking about today. So, Randy Bass has also talked about different kinds of knowledge in our classrooms. And he would say that these preconceptions that students bring sometimes are often the result of our focus on content knowledge, the subject matter itself. And that if we focus just on content knowledge, those preconceptions are at best ignored, at best not addressed, and they simply persist. They simply persist. At worst, we reinforce them. We bolster them. So focusing on content may still do that. Think about the coverage model. I have so much to cover. I focus on my content. But Randy says, there's this idea of method knowledge that can help us break away from that. So in our disciplines, we have the content. I have these texts, this list of texts. But more importantly, for helping students understand the discipline, there are methods, there are habits of mind, ways of thinking, routines, ways of doing in the discipline that led to Barbara Streisand having that entertaining, integrative, engaging lecture that she does privately, and students only see the result of those methods. So how do we teach in ways to engage students in the method knowledge? Often, that's the result of what we might call default pedagogies, the way we were taught. We often teach the way we were taught. What's the problem, or what might be some problems with us simply going into the classroom and teaching the way we were taught? What might be some problems with that?
You may not be engaging students on multiple levels because students interact with the material in different ways because of their own ways of learning.
So students are diverse.
Yes.
They think in diverse ways. They have different interests, different priorities. They may engage in the material differently than I did when I was taught. What are some of the assumptions embedded in that? What are some of the other problems?
One of the problems you have is that the time period between when you were a student and when you were a student, 40 years might have passed, right? The classroom is a very different experience today than it was 30 years ago.
Yeah. And students bring that experience into the classroom, whether we like it or not, and their experiences back years ago are somewhat different. And so we're not being responsive to their experiences. What else? What are some of the other problems with that?
You were letting up with the student.
Absolutely not. Why not?
You went on about your PhD and you're a professor, and so you were very focused on the academics and only a small portion of your class lately. Do you think you should be able to work with students?
Yeah. So the way I was taught worked for me sometimes, sometimes not. Largely because I was incredibly motivated. I loved the subject matter. I did it no matter what. I did it because of the way I was taught and in spite of the way I was taught. I and you are not representative of most of the students in our class. Also, depending on how long ago it was, our memory might not be everything. Remember some of how we were taught, but not necessarily spot on. We also may teach generically. So even if these generic pedagogies are evidence-based, there's good research to show that they engage critical thinking, that they help students write stronger essays, that they help with transfer from one course to another, even if they're evidence-based, and therefore strong in many ways, how do they reflect the discipline still? They may be generic and thinking just about students across the board, learning across the board. How intentional are they with the specific ways of thinking that we want students to practice from our disciplines? How intentional? So, for instance, in our teaching toolkit, a kind of a common metaphor, we may know when to use a hammer versus when to use a screwdriver. Lecture versus discussion. Or think, compare, share versus kind of a bunch of groups doing a jigsaw. But more detailed than that, what about when to use a Phillips screwdriver versus a flathead? What size? So the more nuanced pedagogies that simply evidence-based, that simply discussion, what kind of discussion? What should it look like in a literature classroom? What do discussions of literature look like in the field, and how can I get students to do that in a literature classroom? That's the idea of signature pedagogies. So in 2004, actually, Lee Shulman International Society for the Scholarship of Teaching and Learning, SOL, conference. And there he introduced the idea of signature pedagogies. I was there, I was hooked, I was riveted, I didn't want to make it. The next year, he published this article, it's Googleable, it's online, called Signature Pedagogies in the Professions. Now, he did a lot of work on medicine, engineering, religious studies, and the other one, education. Looking at the different ways professions teach. And he said that they have signature pedagogies, pedagogies that are very specific, tailored to the work of doing law, the work of doing medicine, the work of doing engineering, the work of doing the clergy. He says they contain elements of instruction and socialization. A lovely way of putting it, that idea of socializing students into the field. They embody how to think, how to perform, and how to act with integrity to the discipline. And he says they pre